My name is Bart Kolodziejczyk. I'm a material scientist, nanotechnologist, and I'm based in Melbourne, Australia.
How did you become a nanotechnologist, Bart?
Well, I guess it was a long journey because my background is in mechanical engineering and mechatronics. So back in Poland, where I'm originally from, I did that as my bachelor's. And then I continued for master's, then I did another master's in renewable energy because I got interested in renewable energies. I wanted to explore this field. I wanted to develop new catalysts for solar cells, fuel cells, batteries, etc. Most of these materials are actually nanomaterials, and that's how I became a nanotechnologist, nanoscientist, I guess.
What is nanotechnology?
Nanotechnology deals with very small objects, so nano objects, which is 10 to minus 9 of a meter. So they are very small. You cannot see them with a bare eye. And because of that, you need to use very sophisticated equipment. So you want to see a very small world, but to do that, you need to use large equipment. So it's quite a paradox. Nanoparticles or nanomaterials behave very differently on such a small scale. So you can develop new functionalities in very old materials, materials that you use every day. They can basically behave very differently if you scale them down to a nano level. Another thing is that dealing with nanotechnology is basically scaling something down. So instead of using big bulk systems, you can actually scale them down and achieve the same functions on a much smaller level. And because of that, for example, your microchips can be the same size but more powerful.
The solutions and the opportunities nanotechnology presents seem to be unlimited, but are there any downsides?
Basically, doing research in nanotechnology, at one point I realized that this is amazing. We develop all these new things, new solutions, but there will be a problem in the future. How do we basically manage nano-waste? So waste that originates from nanotechnology. Because nanotechnology and synthetic biology, they can potentially change our lives, virtually any applications, but we need to think about it, how we use it. We have to use it safely, we have to dispose it safely.
Is this a new situation?
The story behind nanotechnology can be compared to a story behind computers. We develop computers, we've been talking about them for many years, but it took some time until we actually got our own PC. Similar story is with nanotechnology. We've been hearing about it for many years, but that was laboratory scale mostly. But recently, we start seeing products that are based on nanotechnology or nanomaterials. The third industrial revolution, which is also called e-revolution or electronic revolution, brought many different electronic solutions, computers, solutions in telecommunication, etc. But we are overflooded by e-waste or electronic waste. It's just too expensive and too complex to basically recycle it or reuse it, and we simply dispose it. Unfortunately, even if we want to, we cannot do the same with nanotechnology. So once nanotechnology product reaches the end of the lifetime, we need to think how to dispose it safely, and we need to think about it right now because later it might be too late.
What makes nano-waste so dangerous? Why is there an urgency in this?
Many of these nanoparticles and nanomaterials are very chemically active. Some of them are even toxic to environment, ecosystems, biodiversity, and human health. And they are also invisible for bare eye. So they can change entire ecosystems or affect our bodies, and we won't even realize why, because we simply cannot see it. So we basically need to think of solutions how to safely dispose these products when they reach end of the lifetime, or better, recycle them if possible. But to do that, we need to basically enforce some regulations, and this has to be done using top-down approaches. So basically governments need to step up and say, oh, we are basically developing this new technology. It is very promising, but we need to regulate it. So how do we dispose safely these products? How do we recycle them? Nanowaste will be growing rapidly with our use of nanotechnology. It is a very different issue to electronic waste or just general waste, because you don't know it is there, but it is there, and it's changing the environments because of the high chemical reactivity, and many of them are highly toxic as well. So this is a new challenge, completely new type of challenge that we never came across before.
Are you involved in this topic?
I started getting interested in this topic of nanowaste, management of nanowaste, disposal, safe disposal, recycling, etc. And basically, I started kind of actively urging governments and different international organizations, trying to develop efficient ways of disposing nanowaste. So I have written several different policy briefs and policy papers, and I try to basically introduce them to UN, OECD, European Commission. Recently, I worked with G20. So basically, I'm a policymaker that acts from bottom up. So I just come up with these ideas and solutions, and then try to basically introduce my ideas to organizations that can make it happen.
What kind of suggestion did you make in these policy papers?
Well, I have created few different policy papers. So different policy papers discuss different issues of the same problem. In some, I kind of establish debate. In some, I propose specific solutions. So some of the things that I'm asking is, who is responsible for establishing whether certain nanomaterial, new nanomaterial, is dangerous or not? How toxic it is? How to dispose it safely? So will it be a researcher who develops this material, for example, in the lab? Or would it be a company that later on uses this material in commercial products? How early do we have to establish whether this material is toxic, etc.? And also some of the things that I mention in my policy papers is that there is a lot of funding to basically take nanotechnology further, to develop new nanomaterials, new applications for them, but not much money is put into establishing whether they are safe, how chemically reactive they are, etc. We need to establish that, how they basically react when we leave them in the environment. They can react differently to different environments. So for example, different environmental conditions will cause different reactions in nanomaterials. If it's dry environment, if it's wet environment, how sunny it is, etc. All these factors play a role in establishing how these materials can affect our health and ecosystems. So basically my policy papers are more of I try to push a debate and discuss all these issues rather than proposing specific solutions.
Could you give me an example about how nanomaterials behave in a different way than normal materials?
So when we basically scale one material to a nano level, they behave very differently. They have very different properties, both mechanical, chemical, etc. For example, when we speak of silver, we use silver in bulk to basically make different type of jewelry. But when we scale it down, silver can become very chemically reactive. So silver nanoparticles are actually used as antimicrobial kind of treatment. So there are, for example, already socks on the market that have some kind of silver nanoparticle coating. And because of that, they don't smell. So you wear them, but they don't smell because they kill all the microbes that produce this odor. And for example, there is one facility in China that produces silver nanoparticles, but the safety standards are not that great in this facility. And basically everything around this facility is kind of dead. It's a bare land because silver nanoparticles killed all the microbes, microorganisms in soil. And without them, basically other plants and animals cannot function because these microbes produce some substances that are essential for other forms of life to exist. And the entire area around the factory is basically bare land, dead, because silver nanoparticles killed some microbes that are actually beneficial for the soil, soil microbes.
As a consumer, can I see if there are some nanoparticles in the products that I am using?
Well, there is no specific kind of sticker that is put on saying that nanotechnology inside or something like that. So you really need to be a chemist and read description, ingredients, to distinguish whether you are dealing with a product that contains nanomaterials, nanoparticles, or not. So for example, many people use toothpaste or sunscreens, but they are not aware that there are nanoparticles of titanium dioxide, TiO2.
Are there any studies about the dangers to our health?
So, for example, recent studies, several of them actually, show that titanium dioxide can cause cancer or affect our nervous system. But no one bans it as yet. So there is no governmental policy to ban titanium dioxide, even though it's widely used in toothpaste, in sunscreens, as an artificial sweetener for food products, etc. I have never heard so far that any government basically stepped up and said, oh, we should ban titanium dioxide. We are using titanium dioxide broadly, but we never realized that there might be issues associated with that.
What has to be done, in your opinion?
I guess one way is to raise awareness. It has to be more kind of consolidated action, because me, myself, I cannot do much, you know. It has to be driven by more people. And there are actually organizations that are already exploring the issue and trying to address it. The process is slightly slow, maybe too slow than it should be. But previously, that was the case with asbestos. So we realized that it's highly toxic. It can cause lung cancer. And basically one government after another followed and they banned it. So I guess at one point it will be a similar case with titanium dioxide. So basically raising awareness is one way. The other way is to basically develop effective and efficient ways of disposing different nanomaterials. And this has to be regulated with some sort of policies.
What would you like that researchers do, that policymakers do, that consumers do?
I guess whenever you develop a new nanomaterial or new nanoparticle, part of your responsibility is also to do at least some basic tests, how these new nanomaterials can affect environments in different environmental conditions, and what can be basically health issues associated with these new nanomaterials. Just basic, that will give idea to whoever wants to use it further to basically do more in-depth tests. Policymakers to regulate the field, to basically develop, to work together with scientists, to develop effective ways for disposing all these nanomaterials, and consumers to be more aware and more educated. But again, this awareness and education has to come from scientists again.
And what will Bart do in the future?
I kind of got intrigued by this science policy field, science advice. And I love it. It is very different to just doing scientific research. It's more interdisciplinary because you need to have knowledge in both law and regulations, and also your specific field of research. So in my case, it is nanotechnology and also synthetic biology, because synthetic biology has similar problems to nanotechnology. So I kind of tried to explore both. That was a great journey, just another journey, very different one. But the output and what I've heard from all these organizations that I worked with was very encouraging. So basically, I got really into it. I really got into a science policy field and science advice. I'm very interested in science law these days. So that's something I would like to continue in my free time. I do all this nano-waste and synthetic biology kind of activities in my free time. It became, in a way, my hobby. It's a bit weird to say my hobby is science policy, but I guess that's what I do in my free time.
What do you focus on right now in your research?
Well, I guess there are many opportunities that arise from research. You have this idea, you develop this idea, you come up with a certain solution. So it's not only about doing research, but doing applicable research that actually helps us to develop further as a community. So I guess that's why at one point I decided to leave. I'm still kind of doing scientific research, but it's more hands-on, more applicable. I'm currently with a Singapore-based company that manufactures state-of-the-art electrolyzers. Electrolyzer is like a electrochemical basically cell where you apply electricity. You have two electrodes, and in our case, we are into hydrogen production. So you put these electrodes into the water and you split water particles, and on one electrode you get oxygen, on the other one you get hydrogen. So we are trying to make a shift towards hydrogen economy. In our company, there is also quite a bit of research. It's very exciting, very novel. So yeah, that's what I do currently.
I guess we have to have one more conversation about this project and the future of energy. Do you see yourself as a change maker?
I guess I don't want to think of myself as a change maker. I do make some change, but I get there using very small steps, so step by step. And eventually you will get there, so slowly but systematically, I guess. In a way, you bring change, but it's not like, you know, you don't make a change over a day or over a period of week, but eventually you will make it.
Who inspired or inspires you?
I guess my mom was one of them, because she gave birth to me. She was always there when we were young to support us. She was very protective. She kind of ignited this curiosity in us, I mean, in me and my brothers. The second very important person in my life was, I guess, my PhD supervisor. I have a massive respect to him, to my supervisor, Bjorn Winter Jensen. He was nearly like a father to not only to me, but also to other PhD students. And I guess right now, the most important person is my fiance, Rantini. We are getting married next year in Malaysia. It will be a Hindu wedding. So there's a lot for me to learn, all the different cultural rituals, all the wedding rituals are very different compared to my European culture, Christian culture. So that will be interesting.
Good luck on all your projects, and I wish you all the best with the wedding preparations.
Thank you, Narina, for having me and for your time.
Thank you so much for this conversation, Bart.